Rightio then. Hello, I think, we've got a lot to get through, but we're going to be really good because we've done this once already, and it's worked, and we're going to do it again, and it's going to be even better. My name is Mark McSherry. I'm from the Virtual School Victoria, and I'd like to just welcome you here today and say music inquiry could be a really, really great subject. Thank you. That's all I wanted to say. But before we begin, I do not represent the VCAA, so everything that I'm saying at the moment is just basically my take on this particular subject, all right? It is not gospel. However, having said that, I have been involved on the panel in developing the new study design, so if you hate certain aspects of it, you can blame me for a little tiny bit. But there are certain things in the study design that I'd immediately change too, but, you know, we've got the study design, that is it. Because I work at Virtual School Victoria, I am in the delightful position of being able to actually prepare courses for next year. I have been given a time allowance to actually sit down and prepare the courses for next year, so I'm about 6 months ahead of you. All right? And that's a really interesting process because as a course writer or course developer, we actually have to do everything and get everything right because when kids come to VSV next year, the course is just sitting there. We've got the entire first unit, or unit three in this case, sitting there. They know what they're doing and they just start and then we do the teaching along with it. So that's a good position to be in, but it's also a little bit scary because we don't have the full information about assessment. So when I start talking about any kind of assessment today, it's my best guess, all right? Because assessment criteria and performance descriptors of things like SACS or the EAT, the externally assessed task, which is the Unit 4 project that the kids do, have not been published as yet, nor have any questions re a sample paper for the examination been published, all those criteria, all right? So what I'm simply doing is what I'm in that same position as you as to going into the study design and trying to work out what the hell it means for the kids. I have the advantage because there were some kind of ways we were trying to do things. So I've been involved in that process. We have at VSBV recently done some publicity in terms of sending things out to schools and putting things on websites. What we had to do was come up with what we thought a short description of the particular subject, of different subjects. By the way, VSV are offering all music subjects next year. Sorry. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Seriously, it's wonderful. Thank
yeah. you. And we are also offering every VCE subject. If it's not next year, it'll be the year after. It's part of a whole government education department push for regional and something or other strategies, etc. And every single subject that is available at VCE, VSV, Virtual School Victoria, will be offering. But we were trying to get publicity out there saying that we were offering all music subjects. This is what I came up with for music inquiry. That's the first bit. To me, this is huge. We are giving the power to the students in Unit 4. They come up with what they want to investigate, and in that investigation will involve performing, creating, analysing, all right? Alongside that, there is responding, and I'll talk about that very shortly, about the difference between analysing and responding in terms of the study design. I think this could be a really great thing because students can perform. Sorry, must perform, they must create, they must analyse, and they must respond. We'll get to that on the next slide. We call these three things music making, which is performing and composing, or creating, I should say, analysing and responding. So they're the three areas of study, all right, in both Unit 3 and Unit 4. So in music making, performing and creating, let's just talk about analysing and responding. This is how I see it, all right? Analysing, when you analyse in this particular state, you know, don't forget about what the word means, but what it means here is in-depth stuff. Investigation, music work styles that may include wide reading, scores if they're being used, contextual information, etc. It's the deep dive into things, going into YouTube, coming back, you know, looking up melodies, coming back. Responding involves perception and understanding of organised sound via listening. It's based purely on the listening side of things. And the responses may include oral or written commentary on music examples as a whole, comments about specific elements, concepts, and or compositional devices. Play me this, what do I hear? How do I respond to that? That is, and in the this is the basis of the exam at the end of the year. So it's actually writing what you are hearing, all right? The big thing in this particular subject is there is no theory or oral testing. This is very much more along style and comp lines for those people who know style and comp. Okay, so they're not going to be asked to write the major scale beginning on D flat. They're not going to be asked what interval is that. If you think of it this way, analysing to me is the asynchronous. You get into the music and you go through it and it takes a week to get through things. Responding in our terms is the synchronous stuff. Play me something, what are you hearing? Tell me about it. This is Unit 3, which is called Influence in Music. In this unit, this is from the study design, through music making and responding, students focus on connections between music created in different times and or places and the influence of one on the other. We're looking for connections between things. And that's going to involve analysing works, and our music making is going to be part of that as well. They are asked to analyse and describe treatments of music elements, concepts, compositional devices in two works and discuss how one work has influenced the other, discussing the connections between them. Pardon me. And please look at the preamble in the study design. Music elements, concepts, compositional devices, they are laid out there. Some of them I disagree with, but there you go, they're there now. And at the end of Unit 3, what they have to do is to formulate a plan for what they're going to be doing in Unit 4. The concept is, if they can do this with stuff that they might be given, for example, and look at the processes they have to do to talk about, to analyse and talk about the connections between pieces, they then go, oh, all right, what could I do that with? What's my interest, what music am I interested in? Can I do the same thing there? Here's just, what they have to do also is to perform a short work that is related to this. They also have to explain how the performance relates to this, and they have to create their own, something or other, short. Think of these things as small and short ideas, but it's based on this area of study. So these things relate to these, to this. These are integrated. Make sense? From a responding point of view, this is listening and responding to selected music from a range of styles and they never describe it. It has the musical characteristics of each and compare similarities and differences. Who's done anything with music comp? Music style and comp. Yep. This is basically the same sort of thing as responding in music style and comp. The one big difference, the one added thing here is you're comparing similarities and differences between two pieces. They could be a piece by Mozart and a piece by Bartok. Two string quartets, hey, put them together. What's this composer doing? What's this composer doing? Why are they different? But it could also be maybe a performance approach, which is a similar or different with the same work. That could be done. Here's just some ideas. Ideas that you could... Ideas, there's a little light bulb. for the responding, here's my take on it. Just let it run. That is, this is going on all the time, and you're going through elements, you're going through compositional devices, you're giving them strategies in how to listen and how to respond to ideas. And you're picking similarities, etc. And the other element, the other aspect of this one is how style or character is created. There is a growing tension in this piece. How has the composer used their resources in order to create this tension? This is going to feed into the exam at the end of the year, so it can't just be about what they're doing here, right? So this needs to be wider, and I'd be suggesting you're getting all the, the minute 30 extracts, the minute extract, the 2 minute extract from a wide range of different things. And a great place to go is the old style and comp exams, etc., that has a whole heap of small little ideas. In analysing, we're in unit 3 still, all right? I reckon you as a teacher can provide starting points. Okay, here's the piece that everyone in this class will be looking at. You're going to do an analysis of this point, of this piece. My idea is to work backwards. You can grab a piece that might be from today or from 1920, whatever, and work backwards. What can you see? Where does this piece come from? Is there someone before that who has influenced this piece? Are there any connections? You can also look at more than two works. They're going to be, the assessment says that they have to analyse two works, but you can actually look at more than two, especially if you're looking at a particular style that might have influenced this piece that you've begun with. and I'll just show you some examples in a minute. They could, if you've decided on a piece and some influence kind of pieces that relate to it, they could perform an excerpt from one of the pieces that they're studying. They could actually perform a piece in just the style of what they've been looking at. They could create a PowerPoint or some sort of multimedia presentation that is talking about how their performance is related to this. And they also have to create a short, small piece of music that is related to this. So all of these things are coming from this bit. These two are integrated. This can stand by itself. That's how I'm approaching it, all right? Couple of other things. For the analysing, they've got to look at two works and then talk about the connections between them. You could possibly just spread the components of that across the unit. So you pick one work, they do an analysis of it. That could be one thing that they do and the teacher sees. They have to hand it in. They do the same thing for another work, which is the influence work. Pure analysis. How are they using melody? What's the structure of the piece, etc. Then they might do a comparison between them. And then they might write a bit more of a discussion point about how these things could be influenced, a bit of context thrown in, etc. At the end of the unit, all they have to do is collate these, say, four pieces, put them together, fix them up a bit because they've got some feedback, and that's the sack for analysis. So we are not asking, in this particular case, we're not asking people to sit in a room and answer questions on a paper. We're putting things together and then providing it. And that could all be a multimedia presentation. I mentioned this before. I like the concept of working backwards. Pick a piece, go back and see where it came from, stylistically, etc. I actually modelled this. I've more or less finished Unit 3. I've made that deadline. I actually modelled something with Missy Higgins' track, which was released about 2 years ago. It was part of the lockdown called When the Machine Starts Up Again. Great little tune, great song, little bit of a chorusy thing in it, and she's really good. She has said that she has been influenced by... by Sarah McLachlan, Canadian singer from the big in the 90s, still around, still doing great stuff, etc. So I've looked at that one. I've gone to this one called, there's a song from the 90s called building mystery, and because I am of a certain age, as soon as you start talking about female singer-songwriters, you have to go back further because, everything comes from Joni Mitchell. So there you go, it just is, all right? And so I've actually looked at this train, just like this train from Court and Spark about 1975. So, and I have found connections in chordal use, in structure, in vocalising, in the way they structure things, in the way they phrase things. There is this strong connection between them. What I'm telling kids, and I don't know if this is going to work or not, but this is what I've come up with. Next year, when all these thousands of students come to VSV to do music inquiry, I say, you're going to have to look at a work. I'm going to be giving you, in Unit 3, a choice of three different works. Here they are. I'm looking at Adele's I Drink Wine from her last album. Beautiful track, has some kind of gospel edges to it. Uptown Funk, Bruno Mars and Mark Ronson, because it is one of the greatest singles ever released in the last 25 years. It is just, I'll tell you the story, when I first heard it, I just fell over. It was great. And a Radiohead song called Burn the Witch from their last album, which includes an entire string orchestra playing either with plectrum. Some people say they're playing with plectrums at the start, or collegno with the back of the bow. But it's percussive, and there's these beautiful, remarkable arrangements in there, because Johnny Greenwood is the guitar player who is also a string, writes a lot of soundtracks, and so knows his stuff, but has put it within this thing. And you can go backwards, again, showing my age. I can find connections between Adele Springfield and Etta James, who Adele has said has been a huge influence on her. You can go back to the Minneapolis funk sounds of Prince, and there are aspects of Uptown Funk which go directly, absolutely directly, to New Orleans funk. And this, you can actually trace, these are just kind of ideas, you can trace that back to the Bowie Eno kind of art music scenes of late 70s, whatever. And if you wanted to, you could actually go into the classical side of things with Penderecki and his use of strings, etc. I don't know if that's going to work. I sure hope it does. At the end of Unit 3, as I said before, they also have to come up with a plan for an area of investigation that they are going to be doing in Unit 4. In Unit 4, they actually complete the project, all right? And I'm sure this is part of an assessment, that is, how well have they put these things together, like as a plan. I'm sure there can be some, you know, might be some slight changes when they actually get to doing this, that the area of investigation just changes slightly. That, to me, is the big one. Unit 3, teacher-driven, set up the processes, set up the modelling of how you can do this sort of investigation backwards, etc. In Unit 4, go on and do it in the area that you want to do it in. That's quite remarkable, I think. In Unit 4, same thing happens. This is from directly from the study design. They deepen their understanding of the influence of music by considering it at a personal level. They move from considering and reflecting on influences in the works of others to applying new understandings of influence in their own music making. Where am I? What has influenced me? What am I going to look at in order, you know, who have I been influenced by and who have they been influenced by? Responding stays the same, basically. It keeps going. Remember, there's an exam at the end. They have to analyse da-da-da-da-da for two works from their area of investigation, and they have to reflect on how those works reflect on what they do. In music making, remember, performing and composing, or creating, they have to present three items. They can do two performances and a composition, or they can do one performance and two compositions. And they could, but they could be performing their composition as well. But there are three items that have to be there. They have to be able to, actually, the study design doesn't actually say that they have to document the relationship to that, these things, but you would. It could be part of that whole idea. I think it needs to be, even though it's not explicitly said there. And at the end, what they do is they bundle up a whole heap of stuff. Text-based things or a multimedia-based ideas of descriptions and their own personal reflection on their own personal stuff, analysis of the two works that they've chosen, at least one visually recorded live performance of works over there, and at least one recorded audio and composition. So performance, composition, and they can choose, and there's three items, two performances and a composition, or two compositions and one performance, okay? So what might that look like? I'm going to bring my Able assistant. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Sadie Musto, who I had the great fortune of teaching last year, doing style and comp at VSV, who is now, she did really well, making waves concert, she was in Top Sounds, she's good. She's also, I was going to say, a fiddle player, a violin player, and kind of has studied violin and works that way, but she's at the VCA, doing interactive composition with quite a few other VSV kids. I just thought I'd show what I think one could actually achieve if a student did music investigation. And so I said, Sadie, would you be willing to do it? And she said, yes, sure. And I said, well, you're going to have to come up with an area of investigation. She said, huh? And I said, well, I'll write it for you. What is your area of investigation, Sadie?
Female singer-songwriters in the previous 20 years that straddle different styles while producing works relevant to their own personal circumstances.
And you're going to look at two specific songs. The first one will be...
Enchanted by Taylor Swift.
And the second one will be...
Lipstick on the Glass by Wolf Alice.
Wolf Alice is actually a band with a very strong female lead vocalist. And I'm going to ask you this, why Taylor Swift, Sadie?
Because she is an incredible songwriter. I remember the first time I ever listened to her very well, because we were driving down to our holiday house at Easter and my mum had just bought the CD, and so she put it into the car, and I just remember being blown away by her songwriting.
There you go. And for the next 5 or 6 years, posters all over the walls. Yeah. Tragic trailer. What are they called? The Swifties.
No.
Swifties. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So therefore, you can imagine going a deep dive, analysing those two songs, looking at how they might be connected, as well as the connection to this student performer, and then someone pulls out a video camera and says, "Okay, I'm going to record you performing. What are you going to perform? I'm going to perform the Enchanted, the song that I've actually analysed by Taylor Swift."
Your eyes whispered, "Have we met?" Across the room, your silhouette starts to make its way to me. Playful conversation starts, counter all your quick remarks like passing notes in secrecy. And it was enchanting to meet you. All I know is I was enchanted to meet you. Enchanting to me.
Sadie Musto, who's her second single. Is this the second single has just been released. I'll put up the website in a minute. Okay, so she's done a performance and it's very good, and she gets very high marks because it's a brilliant performance and she's exceptionally talented. If you were analysing that, you could actually see the type of chords, very triadic harmony, nothing special about the progressions, it's kind of pretty straightforward, rhythmically it's there. It has a very low kind of verse structure, melodic is down here. Then in the chorus it goes up. There is also something specific about it?
Yeah, in the second verse it starts off lower and then it jumps up an octave in the second half.
Right, so the second half actually goes up the octave, same line, but it's there. And so Sadie has said, well, I'm going to write something that has been influenced by this. I would like to introduce Sadie Musto with an original composition called Dear You.
Dear you, you know who you are. You've known from the start. I wish I'd said sorry for breaking your heart. But still an open wound. You and me painted in blue. It's been years, but it still hurts. So now I'm saying sorry with my words. But now I've seen shades of yellow, like rays of glitter forming through the clouds, like winter into spring. And now I keep imagining bumping into you on a busy street, long enough to say I'm sorry. Dear you, you were always so kind, if not a little shy, yet I'd always avoid second high. But now let me explain, making a mistake. Well, I did that anyway, but now I've seen shades of yellow, like rays of glitter falling through the clouds, like winter into spring. And now I keep imagining bumping into you on a busy street. I'm sorry, sincerely.
She's pretty good, and I read that little high bit in the head bit at the business was great. It was
very
lovely,
Joni.
Very Joni. Right. Do you know Joni Mitchell?
One song,
which is Big Yellow Taxi.
True song.
Ah, well, yeah, one of the greatest songs ever written. Yes. Yeah, thank you, Sadie. Yeah, brilliant. This is, to me, what inquiry can be, all right? It is an exploration of things. If you're looking at a specific thing, here's a bit of a description. I wrote it. It's there. This might be the sort of thing that you would find as at the in the Unit 3 planning thing, okay? This is the sort of thing that I want to be investigating, and I'm going to do a deep dive into that sort of thing. Here are my two songs. I'm going to be doing these things here. Open My Eyes, by the way, is the new single. And when they submit it, maybe a videotape of a performance, audio of these two things might also be a video as well. And then here, maybe there are three elements that is also put in. Now, these could be written, or they could be kind of a multimedia presentation as well, with people, you know, with things and a voiceover on it. Wouldn't that be great? Okay, so we're not asking in inquiry. They don't actually have to write. They can choose to write this, or you might, you know, as a teacher, sometimes it's easier to kind of go, can you just write this out? But that would then all be put together. This is the EAT, the externally assessed task. This is the project. you bundle them all up and you send them to the VCAA. Just in general. Unit 3, coursework, worth 30% of the mark. Unit 4, coursework, which is only a SAC based on listening, based on the responding, is only worth 5%. The external assessed task, the big project, is now worth 50%. So it's the equivalent of the performance subjects, and now it's the equivalent of the composition subject. This is the big one. And there is an end of year examination, but it's only worth 15%, but it's 15%, and it is only based on outcome 3, right? So it's the listening and responding thing. And like I said, the sample papers have not been published, but from being on the panel, for those people who know style and comp and the questions in the in performance exams in the past, there was a push from the panels to say, are there other ways of asking questions in these kind of responding things? That, you know, are there tables that we could use? Are there checkboxes? Are there multiple choices, etc.? That sort of thing, rather than only kind of putting lines and proses, to try and get away from, as we all know, kids who can write well tend to do better. That has been kind of mooted in the past. Those two words were the beginning of this whole process. How do we create more access for students in the senior years doing music, and how do we deal with equity? This is what I showed you at the beginning. And I reckon this is a pretty good start, at least. I think Music Inquiry is there to capture the wider group of music people who may not be playing eighth grade oboe in year 11. And just finally, if you want to talk to me, that's me. It's M. McShare without a Y, because we only allowed 8 characters. that's where you can find us all up to find out more about VSV. And that's Sadie's website. You can go there, have a listen to a new song called Only You? Only Open My Eyes. Open My Eyes. And that will do me, because right now I'm going to hand over to the lovely Matt Ridgway, who's going to look at inquiry just from a slightly different aspect. Thank you. And we'll have some questions, like 5 minutes of questions at the end.
My presentation, I guess, is Music Inquiry for Digital Music Makers. I work at Sydney Road Community School, where I've been teaching a VET music course for the last 15-ish years. The focus of that has been moving from like a band program or like performance and a sound like person, sound production person. There's this new music maker in the middle, where those two things are together. And I also work for a company called Ableton, where I provide free licenses to schools and free professional development to schools also. So that's who I am. Why am I here? Why as a person who teaches VET music, speaking at a VCE music conference? Great question. I guess because there are these new people out here, these digital music makers that the VCAA have referred to, but maybe these students don't refer to themselves like that. They may not even refer to themselves as musicians, actually. They might be a producer, they might be a beat maker, they might be a rapper, they might just like games, soundtracks, they might be all of those things and more. And so they're out there. The students that I once saw at Sydney Road who came in at year 8 shredding on guitar, like self-taught or self-taught from a person who was like in their family or a friend, or tabs, I don't see them as often anymore. I see the kids shredding on a door. You know, they're making music. They've already made beats. They're already composing. It's really common these days to see that. And I'm certainly seeing a lot of that. So why is music inquiry this particular subject? Thanks. So great for these students. Well, I mean, this is what Mark showed before. This is primarily the reason why it's great. It's because of the weighting of the tasks. There's a much larger percentage which is around the portfolio task, and then the school assessed coursework, which is 30%. So that's an 80% total of the total mark that is within the control and interest of the students. Let's look at that a bit more. So Unit 3, I think, provides an opportunity to investigate influence within a musical genre or an artist of interest to that student. They get to perform, create, explain music-making processes in relation to its influence. And the structure of the coursework can actually provide like a scaffold or a template that students would then use in Unit 4. I think in a similar way to like Mark's idea of like, you know, teacher-led and then student-led, that this is, you're able to provide a scaffold, like a kind of an example of ways in which you can structure the work for that student to then do it independently in Unit 4. I don't really need to talk to that because Mark's already talked about that, but I will mention that there are some resources on the VCAA website around digital music makers that I've created, and it includes this. And this, in fact. So this is just a kind of like an example of like what a Unit 3 may look like. If we did a unit or a course of work that was around sampling or plunderphonics, as they call it, like we're just kind of like grabbing different bits and pieces from different musical artists and mashing it up together. I should mention this is just mine. You can take photos of it all you want. It's also on the VCAA website. It's totally fine for you to use any of it if you like, or none of it if you like, if you totally disagree. It's just like a proof of concept in some ways. But here's the three outcomes. And I guess what the idea is we're providing different opportunities throughout like the unit of work to do different bits. You might do some music making, like creating or performing around when you're investigating sampling. You might like go, well, let's talk about sampling. Let's use a sample in our own music making. Let's make a 4-bar beat. Let's make a 16-bar beat. We might analyze it. Then maybe we could do some responding, go backwards in time, like Mark was just talking about, like move backwards from current practices. Okay, where did all this sampling begin? Let's look at, you know, early tape experiments, music concrète, all that kind of thing. You might listen, contrast sample-based works from different eras in hip-hop. You might compose something that used like loop-based work or like a... And you can include like a completed DAW project file or an MP3 of the final track. You don't need to create a score. You don't need that anymore. You could just make a multimedia presentation which annotates some of these like screenshots of work, or a track deconstruction, like a talk through of what their processes are as they play back the file. One part of this is around performance, and I was trying to jump up and mention earlier on when someone asked that question about, well, how do you perform with electronic, like how does this beat maker perform? There are so many ways of performing using electronic music. One of them is just a mashup style performance, finger drumming, live looping, on and on and on, using effects. There's a bunch of different things, so I'm going to talk about that. What does it look like? The performance can capture like a live performance of them on video. This is something I did with my vet students. These students are performing a mashup. We did a whole bunch of different stuff around it. This is during lockdown, so they did it all at home with their phones and taught them how to do that. It was relatively simple. To capture the audio and the video at the same time. Some did it quite differently. Some took a screen capture with a camera. Others did overhead camera. Some added extra things. It was quite fun. So this is outcome one of Unit 3. So they might then create an oral written presentation around it. So this might be, Google Slides or a Keynote or whatever, or a whole bunch of different things. You can incorporate a bunch of these different bits into it. What I've done during rehearsals, how I'm using, I don't know, whatever. This is just from my vet things. You would come up with different stuff based upon what you're doing. And then an audio or video recording of their work, their compositions. Okay, so this is then analysis. So if we're comparing influences of two works, they might make a multimedia presentation of that. So what I'm trying to do here is give them a bunch of skills or like techniques that they can then use in their in unit four for their when they do their project, because they have to create a portfolio of work. So you're trying to sort of help them along the way by doing these scaffolded tasks. You might, you know, give them a few prompts and go, okay, these are the types of things that you're going to do. We're going to have musical excerpts with annotations. You're going to go, this is a track that I've like references, you know, two different tracks, and maybe you're going to talk about this, and maybe you could write about a particular technique you used in this track and another technique in this one. You can explain the context and the background of the works. You can do all sorts of detail, the compositional devices, all the things that are outlined in the study design. Then the investigation proposal moves into Unit 4. So as Mark mentioned before, like the idea of the final bit of Unit 3 is around this developing of investigation proposal, where they write about like an area that's going to be have that they're interested in, this further something that's going to be an area of further investigation for them. So, you know, they might think about it like a range of different things. They might think about like including the title, the detail of the description, a rationale why I'm doing it. You might list the two, well, you have to list the two works and briefly describe the connection between those two works. And then you might also like include something about a concept for your composition that you're going to create in your project, or a concept for your performance, or a concept for your third work, which could be a performance or a composition. So that would be part of what that investigation proposal might look like. And then the structured questions we've talked a little bit about before, the previously unheard excerpts. I guess here, like I would probably try to, it says in the study design, it's either oral or written responses, oral and written responses. So I'd just be thinking about maybe providing opportunities for both of those. So maybe there's some of those things you could think about when you're doing that. Okay, so some of you go, well, I've never seen electronic music performance before, or maybe some of you are, I'm not making assumptions here. If you're interested, I've got a collection of videos that I'm just gonna always add to. So if you would like to QR code that at some point, or I will provide this later. It's just a YouTube playlist. It's got 48 videos of electronic music performances and different ways in which you can perform using electronic music tools, including finger drumming, live looping, using it as effects, clip launching, more sort of techno sort of style, more sort of hip-hop sort of style things, a whole bunch of different things. And here's another one for maybe if you're after some works like that you want to use as part of your analysis and you want to include a variety of works, maybe this playlist. But again, you don't have to do it right now. I can send it to you later. Okay, so how would I approach Unit 4? Here's the breakdown. It's a project, it's the main thing is the portfolio task. And it does allow a deep dive into a creative process, a technique or a genre. And they get to develop a popular portfolio of material. Like, that's really useful for a musician to have. Like, beyond an ATAR score, it's just really useful, like, to have the skills involved in doing that, right? So, I mean, coming from someone who teaches VET, where it's, you know, satisfactory, not satisfactory, we don't rank in VET. You know, I guess that's a whole extra level of thinking about it. But, you know, in here, there's this great opportunity for a student to do a real deep dive into what they're interested in. And again, area study, music making, analysis, portfolio, school assessed, coursework, 15%. All right, so, I thought I fixed this. It should say portfolio example one. I know, silly me. So I've just given you, what I'm doing here, I've got three different examples of portfolio tasks for three different types of digital musicians. So the first one, this area investigation is for the hip hop kid who's interested in sampling, techniques and influences, processes used in underground hip hop. There's two works, J Dilla and Idolism. And they can present those three works in their portfolio. Might be one video recording of them doing a live finger drumming performance, hitting buttons, playing the trigger, playing back in real time. Will be a reflection document that outlines what techniques and things they were doing, what compositional devices they were using within that. And then maybe if they're more kind of production based, so the kids, they might then do two recordings and annotate that type of work, using screenshots of the project files, discussing stuff like that, really reflect upon what they're doing and the techniques and how they're influenced by these tracks and that technique. Then portfolio example two proper this time. So this one, it's the kid who's into video games and soundtracks. And the area of investigation is very specific here, the use of distortion and audio effects in contemporary film and game music. So they're taking deep dive into specific techniques used in modern cinema and game music. Here are the two works. Mick Gorton, an Australian composer who did Mad Max, recent Mad Max films, and Tom Holkenberg Tom Holkenberg did Mad Max. Mick Gorton's a game composer, he made the Doom soundtrack. And then, again, with this one, there's three presentations of works. One is a live performance. They might use like a push or something to like manipulate effects in real time, play back part of their original composition, and then reflect on that technique, those techniques. Then there might be two original works, one within the style of Mick Gorton, another one demonstrating techniques in the style of that particular artist. And then there's a third example, which is a slightly different take on this. So this is maybe like the student who's like, I'm just trying to think of maybe, I guess it's maybe a young person who's done a bunch of like learning already, but maybe it's say year 9 or year 8, they kind of didn't want to follow the A&E B path. So they might be a piano player or a guitarist or a singer and have just gone, actually, you know what, I'm kind of done with that learning. I want to do me. And they might be interested in using technology or something like live looping. So for people unfamiliar with live looping is the kind of capturing of audio in real time and then layering and composing like a work based upon the audio that's been captured. So there's a bunch of different contemporary artists who use this technique. So here are two artists where that work's being analysed, so Rachel K. Collier and Kawahi. And there's two different works that are on YouTube you can have a look at. And then in the presentation section, this student might do two performances where they're using like this live looping processing stuff, reflection documents, and then they would also create one audio recording of their original work using that performance and make a presentation around it. So that's how I'd approach it. I guess the kind of like final bit, I thought there was one more, stay in touch. If you're interested, hit me up. I am always interested in connecting with teachers, and I'm also running an event, like a free workshop at Arts Centre Melbourne around practical strategies and planning for an inclusive VCE Music Inquiry program, inclusive in that talking about digital musicians. And if you're interested in attending that, if you've got these students, you're not really sure where to start with them, I'm your person, I can help, I can do all different things. If you've got specific topics you want covered, here it is. Scan that, put them in, or just hit me up like on the emails. I would like to hear from you. I think Mark and I, we've got 5 minutes or something. We can answer any questions about anything we've covered. Hi.
Hi, my name is Carlos. In regards to a lot of this, so obviously Ableton is you've got that as part of your environment, your curriculum. It looks like, by the way, that you're sort of wanting or thinking, envisioning digital music makers to engage with this curriculum. They sort of need to have a good fluency around their door. To what extent, you know, do you implement that at younger year levels in preparation for it? Because it almost means like you have to, do you either pick your poison and say, all right, we're an Ableton program from 9 and 10 or 11, or if you just sort of let it happen organically and trust that students develop that on their own?
I can answer that. Like, my vet students start at year 11. Some have some knowledge and some have zero knowledge. Yeah. And over 2 years, they're able to develop a bunch of things. I teach music. I don't teach Ableton. I just want to like clarify that. Like, because it's like it's about music making processes, and it's just like another tool to use. It's sure. Like it can be an instrument, can be a recording platform, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. I'm not here to sell it to you. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's So yes, but at the same time, this is what students are coming with. These are the skills that they're bringing to the table these days, a lot of students.
My name's Daniel. It's probably a follow-on question from that, actually. We've started playing around with some really basic tools in my program because it's locked down for removing the soundtrack, which is much less sophisticated than Ableton. But something I've found really tricky is with composition, distinguishing between very kind of generic prefab loops and stuff that's more original, which happens to sound like the prefab loops because it's a common kind of beat or scroll organisation. Do you have any thoughts on how we might, authenticate assessment, both for us, but also for us to have confidence in how it might be assessed in the E? Because I'm very much got a classical background, a school that has very much a concert band tradition. Kids are starting to come in. There's definitely a need for some kids to be on the door, but I'm feeling a bit nervous about it, and appreciate any thoughts you have.
Yeah, sure. It's a really great question, and like you're not alone here. I was speaking to Tim from VSV earlier. I'll just do a little diagram, right? So this is the curriculum. The cool thing about the new study design is that it allows a greater opportunity for these types of musicians to engage. So that's the first thing. Then you've got your students, right? You just have to appreciate my teacher writing that, so students. And here's you, right? These are the skills and experience that you bring in. So what you're aiming for is here, right?
Yeah.
So what are you in control of? You're really just in control of your own skills and experience. Like, you can shift a little bit, can't you, towards the students? So you maybe it's just like taking some professional learning around this. You know, and I know everyone's time poor and whatever, but like, I don't know, does that answer?
Can I just add something there? I teach the IB course, and we've had to do a lot of that this year. And it is amazing what the kids can figure out by Googling. YouTube's an extraordinary thing. It's not my area of expertise. A lot of the time they're teaching me. It's okay to not know as much as they do. It works.
Yeah.
You've just got to jump off the bridge, basically.
Yeah. Just about, my concern is mostly around assessment, in that I need to be able to, have a sense of how the it's going to come across. And for internal assessment, sometimes I find it challenging to tell the difference, and that's because I do need to do some PD, I do need to have a deep dive into styles of interest to students. It's challenging because great prefab packages are available. But to tell the difference between that and something the students created, I find, maybe the answer is to take your excellent PD and I'll do this. But if you have any quick thoughts, just something that, it's tricky for me and others, I think. Yeah.
There's a course on LinkedIn as well, it's about a 40-minute course. You have to pay about $40, but it's really deep dive into, beginners into Ableton. I found that really useful.
I can do PD for free. I can point you in the direction of James Humberstone's amazing, his Sydney Uni, I can't remember. MOOC. A MOOC. Which is like talks about the why behind all of this also. But you're 100% right about students leading the way. I learn stuff from students every year, and I think I'm pretty good at it.
This is a question for Mark or anyone who has been part of the designing of this new study design course. I also teach the IB, and in the IB we identify students as researchers, creators and performers, and I can see there's a lot of similar language is in this VCE course. So I'm wondering, where did VCAA look? Did they look to the IB and did they look at other programs nationwide and globally to design these?
The answer is yes. Not, I can't, the IB, I'm not too sure, but there was certainly a lot of work in the early stages of programs around the country. Looking at what New South Wales does, Queensland's doing some really interesting stuff. And I, yeah, I wasn't allowed to do some of the things that I wanted to do. Because it, you know, the structure was slightly, the structural kind of side of things was different. And so I had, you know, great plans of mapping. Yeah. If anyone wants a really good curriculum, look at the Queensland one. It maps everything from the starting point and you just reach the end, it's great. But that was all, yeah. I'm not too sure about how much IB was involved, but they certainly looked at various areas, and it sort of then started to gel together. But with the with VCE, there are, as Marg will keep telling you, there are some strict rules in the way things have to be put together, basically, and the committees and the panels that it has to go up, that are higher than us mere musicians.
I understand the assessment criteria hasn't come out yet, but do you have any idea what sort of length the analysis task for the project would be, like 1,000 words, 10,000 words?
Oh,
or,
no.
You know, what sort of, you know, 5 minutes? 20 minutes, yeah.
Absolutely none. Like, I don't know, but if they said 1,000 words, I'd be, you know, I'd be at the barricades. This is a large thing, right? They've got to actually arrange video. It has to be videoed. A live performance has to be videoed, right? Plus the recordings, etc. Or, you know, I'm sure a lot of them will kind of either produce audio from Sibelius or whatever, plus all the other stuff that goes with it. And like analysis, I'd be kind of a one-page analysis of one page. Like, don't quote me on that, but also remember that we don't want, someone's got to sit in a room as an assessor and go, okay, here's this person's project, and about, 10 minutes of it is going to be performances and composition. Then there's this other stuff with it. You don't want to... My best guess would be it won't be too onerous. And I think the other thing that, from a study design panel kind of point, was that we were trying to get away from the writing idea. Because, as we know from a responding point of view, if people are right in the past, if people are good writers, they tend to do better. So we're trying to work at different ways, as I said. Did I say that before?
Yeah.
Trying to work at different ways of getting knowledge and understanding represented, rather than, you know, writing in large paragraphs.
I'm super keen on trying to increase my literacy in these sorts of DAWs, again, similar, classical formation, that kind of thing. But I'm fascinated by all this. And I've made personal investments in some of this stuff, but as a teacher, trying to find the resources to educate and learn how to make music in an efficient way, rather than bashing my head against the internet, which a teenager can do until they go blue in the face. But I guess the opportunity, are you aware of opportunities or people who train and be like, hey, look, you want to use this particular, this is how I make music with this, and streamline that process.
Call Matt.
Yes.
He gives you licenses, he gives you push controllers. Am I allowed to say that?
So, to answer the question, my job at Ableton is to teach teachers how to use it for free. And I give licenses, I give all of these different things. VSV's been at the recipient, a recipient of that as well as. So in terms of, I can't teach a class for you, do you know what I mean? You lot. I could run a workshop, but I'm not going to. It's not in my remit.
Katie Wardrobe is also great.
I can see the increased need for this and for this sort of literacy across not just the VCE teachers, but frankly all music teachers. And then you can only effectively implement something like this in your curriculum from 7 to 12 if the majority of your teachers are fluent in this, to an extent, I don't need them selling.
Yeah, but also, I don't want to devalue anyone's experience here. I feel like you're not teaching. If I was in an English class, an English teacher, I wouldn't be teaching Microsoft Word. I'd be teaching English. We're music teachers. That's what we teach. It's just a way through which students learn music. Yeah. Another way.
Yeah.
so there are some great organisations out there that actually have really practical help for, you know, early secondary classroom teachers to make sure there are resources that are accessible, but also curriculum design and how you might go about implementing that in your classroom, whether you've got, you know, regardless of what sort of demographics your school has, and I guess the question, you know, that you have to decide the school is how that sort of fits in with the limited time of God and where it all works.
Yep,
certainly my understanding and my experience has been that the kids don't need you to teach them the context. They need you to take the risk to open up the classroom space to that.
I've got kids who are brilliant and can do this, and I'm not worried about them at all, because they're gonna sort themselves out. I'm thinking of the kids who are like curious about it but just need a guiding hand. And I know right now where I sit, I can't be that for them. And that, but that just needs a little bit more training on my part. So that's what I'm thinking about when I'm saying I want to increase my literacy. It's basically because I'm in that diagram, I'm trying to push myself more and more towards the students. But I need to do that. And looking for opportunities to do so. Yeah, that'd be great.
Just a question on the outcome 2, the analysing. So you put I like the model you had, like you sort of have one work in one term, one work in the second term, and then you bring it together. Then for the SAT, say, were you suggesting that then you present the students with some alternatives for them to go away and...
For the unit, we're talking unit 3 here, yep. So unit 3, I'll tell you what I've done. I've given them 3 tracks, you choose one of the 2, I've called it the focus track, so it's your focus track, and you then do the deep dive into the history or where it comes from. And I've just provided them with about 10 to 12 kind of YouTube things, an interview with someone, a couple of tracks, you know, on YouTube, etc., an article from something. So I've done that researchy thing. It's then their job to go, okay, what am I gonna choose? Here's my beginning one. What am I gonna choose as my influence one? And then look at the process between them.
And I mean, that would be sort of a longer, like not sort of a sit down for an hour and do it, but it's a longer...
Yeah, and that was the idea of spreading things out across the, you know, they do analysis of 1, analysis of 2, then they do it, and maybe there are 3 things that they put, and then they put it together. That was a brainwave I had. It was kind of like, because they're doing the work all the way through, because at VSV, we kind of get them to send things in, and then we comment on them and stuff, and then all they need to then do is just collate them. And then that's their SAC.
Yeah.
And that's kind of like, it's not a high level stress then.
We've had great examples from you both, sort of students working in a digital space and contemporary singer-songwriter space. Would the music inquiry equally be suited to a classical student who perhaps communicating with a written word is not their strength?
Communicating with the?
Written word. Portfolio.
There is nothing that would, you know, I'm just thinking, quick, you could look at, you could look at a Bartok quartet, and then you could look at, a Beethoven quartet, you know, and you could do the connection, da-da-da, then they would play a little bit of that, and then write about it. Yeah, absolutely, yeah. And it's just, I guess, from, I think, both our point of views, that part of the aim of all of this is to open it out, but there is absolutely no reason why anyone with that kind of thing could do exactly the same stuff. Yeah. It's 25 past, there is a voluntary, what's the word? Optional, it's not voluntary, an optional thing happening at 3:30. I just want to thank you for all coming, and I really hope that you're willing to kind of embrace some of these new ideas. Yay.